What's up, guys? Today's subject is how did we earn over 100,000 on stock photography and how can you do better? Okay, it sounds great. Whoa, over 100,000, and I think it's even closer to 150,000, but it's difficult to check the numbers exactly. After 10 years of experience, I decided to share some insights and some experiences with you guys. And I think it's super important you watch it to the very end because we'll be sharing some very important observations. I want you, Jack Sputnik subscribers or people new to this channel or just people that are thinking of starting their stock photography career, to avoid some of the traps and pitfalls and mistakes we made over these 10 years. So I have a list that we did with my wife because we always work together in stock photography. We are a family and we are always together. And now my son is always with us. He's always interested. What is daddy doing, shooting there, you know, operating these strange things. And I have another baby on the way. So the family is growing. And we are not going to stop. We are going to do more photographs, more videos, and sell it on stock. So I want you to know how to do it in the best way, how to make the best use of your time and resources. So my first tip here is organize your workflow. And I mean, I know it sounds basic, but wait, before you say, okay, this is basic, I already know it. We made so many mistakes, like coming back from some big trips, I don't know, around the United States or to Africa. I was so excited. I knew that I had these frames and I had them in my mind, like the best shot of Manhattan or some best shot of African guy in canoe. And this is a huge mistake. So our workflow is four steps. Download your card, select photos, process only selected photos, keyword those photos, and then upload to multiple stock agencies. For keywording, we use tools provided by Shutterstock. And next week in the episode about keywording, in tutorial about keywording, I will be talking in depth how to save a whole lot of time on keywording and uploading to multiple stock agencies. So once again, first download your card and do selection and then process only selected photos. Otherwise, you will be stuck in huge mess because you will not exactly know after months and weeks or days which photos you already processed, which you didn't, which you should process, which you shouldn't. So this will save you like a whole lot of time. Believe me, I've been there, okay? And one more thing when it comes to organizing your workflow is be consistent. Finding maybe specific time in the week to shoot and specific time in the week to process and upload may be very helpful. From our experience, finding specific time, setting aside specific hours during the day to shoot, select, edit, and upload is very important because consistency pays off. And I can give you a lot of examples. Like usually during summers, we have a lot of weddings and we upload way less. Last summer, we had so many that we uploaded almost nothing. And Shutterstock immediately went down. Our sales started to go down. Then we started to be regular again and it started to go up again. So this really works. We tested it, being regular uploader. It doesn't have to be 100 photos a week. It doesn't have to be, I don't know, 200 photos a week, 10 photos a week, 20 photos a week, 50, how much you can do, but be consistent. Then another point very much connected to organizing your workflow is don't waste your time. And one of the biggest mistakes of newbies in the stock photography business is to check your sales on your smartphone every 5 minutes, every 10 minutes, every hour, 10 times, 20 times a day. Don't. First of all, you may burn out very fast checking your sales. It's like YouTube. If you check for subscribers and, you know, like watch time and so on, this will make you really tired and it's not productive at all. And having said that, it's good to monitor your sales. Like I monitor my YouTube growth. It's good to know what people want, what sells, but doing it like, I don't know, once a day, maybe once a week, it's totally enough. You will know which photos sell and which are not selling well. Stock photography is a source of extra money. In most cases, it will not be your main business. And however, $100,000 or $150,000 is a significant amount of money, it's not your main source of income in most cases. So you don't want to spend all your time on shooting, all your time on editing, all your time on doing stock photography business. In the meantime, you can do so many things. If you're a photographer, you can do interior photography, you can do weddings like we do. We did, like last year, we did over 150 interior photo shoots. We did some weddings, we did like family sessions, pregnancy sessions. It's all available. There are clients for that kind of services out there, and you can earn way more if you stay organized and if your stock photography is in the right place. Which brings us to the next point, which is don't overshoot. I think it's one of the main points here. It's like, if you overshoot, if you shoot too much, and I'm saying, like, let's say like last week we went shopping, just normal grocery, and I took my Sony A7 III with 50 millimeter lens to make it, you know, light and quick. And we wanted to take some shots of us wearing masks and doing shopping. And those pictures already started to sell, and I think it will do very well. But the point is to do it like for 15 minutes, 20 minutes, half an hour, get the right angles, get the right shots, and when you feel you got it, just stop shooting. There's one thing that may be really overwhelming in the stock photography career is to have these archives on your drives growing until it becomes like a monster and it wants to eat you and it wants to kill you, and the last thing you want to do is to access this drive and process those photos. It's a big challenge, and I really, really want you to stop shooting when you feel you are done with the session. The next thing is invest in good equipment. And however, on that channel I said that you can shoot with entry-level DSLR camera for stock photography. You can even shoot weddings with entry-level DSLR cameras. And I think I'll be doing episode about that in near future. Nowadays, entry-level DSLRs are really good quality, and they can do more than enough. And when I'm saying invest in good equipment, I'm not saying only about cameras, because with entry-level DSLR, with kit lens and some good prime lens, you're pretty set. But having said that, invest, for example, in good computer. And I remember having my laptop that I bought in 2014, somewhere in Las Vegas. It was Asus with i7, and for many years I thought it's such a great laptop. I loved it so much. It was so durable and lightweight, and I could plug it into external monitor that was not calibrated, and so on and so on. So eventually I learned the lesson. You have to change your equipment from time to time. You have to invest in good computer. And actually investing in workstation, in a custom built PC, was one of the best investments I made recently. I never ever see any progress bars on these computers. However, laptops nowadays are very capable, and I'm not saying they are either laptops are better or workstations are better. Those workstations are still better. But invest in the best computer you can, because this will save you a lot of time. Editing is a very intense process for your computer, and you need something to do it quick. And that brings us to next point. Become efficient editor. Keyboard shortcuts and knowing your software, whatever it is, if you're using free software like Darktable or RAW Therapy, or you're just using Lightroom or Bridge and Camera Raw like I do, which is pretty much the same thing, be efficient with using it. Master your skills. Invest your time in tutorials. I have one tutorial about basic editing skills. Not here. I have one tutorial about that, so please don't forget to check this one out. And also learn shortcuts on your keyboard. This will save you a whole lot of time, and you will be more effective. You will upload and process and upload more photos. And one more point about editing, photo editing or video editing, is to do it right. So if you edit like you feel that you are tired and you don't edit your photo right, or you don't remove all the logos, usually you will have this photo or video rejected. And I did it 100 times. I was tired. I tried to edit photos and I was almost like falling asleep in front of my computer. And then I had photos rejected. Don't do it. It's a waste of time. edit your photos, right? If it's noisy, try to remove noise. If it's not sharp, forget about this picture. It won't work. But there's one catch. Don't overprocess your photos and don't overprocess your videos. Please. This is not good. We learned it the hard way, and I've been trying like desaturated photos that leave a lot of space for editors, and I tried to, you know, oversaturate and overdo the photos, and then it doesn't really sell. And that brings us to point number three, which is the last point today, and this is shoot the right things. And when we started in 2010, we had no idea what to shoot. And the market since then changed a lot, a couple of times. And we heard so many times that stock photography is dying and nobody wants this businessman shaking their hands and this stuff anymore. And that's very true, because the time of business handshakes, you know, and making deals in groups and smiling and fake light is permanently gone. This really doesn't sell that well anymore. I mean, it does sell probably, but not too much. We tried and we never got too far with that. So nowadays, like good lifestyle photos, natural looking photos, business photos, industry photos, medical photos, any type of photos where access is limited and difficult and there's a big industry behind, will get you sales. And that brings me to one extra point, which we learned also recently: focus more on videos than on photos. I mean, we will still be uploading photos, but we will focus way more on videos. This is the big thing right now, and a lot of stock photographers and videographers will share the same opinion. And one important tip that I learned in my stock photography career is try to explore new things. You may be very good in, I don't know, mountain bike riding or, I don't know, skating or something like that, and you want to shoot mainly that. And this is good because you are good in that, your heart is there. But trying new things can be super exciting. This is one of the things I love about stock photography, that it allowed me to enter places and be in situations that I would never ever find myself doing some other kind of job. And this is like adventure in stock photography. And I love it. And though we have some things that we love to do and then we love to shoot, and for example, we love traveling, and most of our portfolio is about travel photography, but we love, for example, heavy industry. We love to access some strange places like where they repair airplanes, where like, or coal mines. We have very good coal mine collection on stock, and it sells really, really well. So my tip is, be adventurous, try new things, explore new areas, learn new things, and this will keep you excited and this will keep you fresh with your stock photography portfolio. And one last extra tip that I want to give you: quick extra sessions with your friends. They have some cool jobs. Some of them run cafes, some of them work in some strange places, laboratories and stuff. And sometimes you may just want to have a walk by the beach with them and do some lifestyle shots, or maybe riding their bikes or any kind of stuff they ride. This is a great idea to collaborate with your friends. Usually they are super happy to be part of your portfolio because they know you as a photographer, videographer, about crazy creative guy. And they will say yes in most of the times. Of course, you need to sign model release with them, but this is a great source of like cool images and a lot of good fun. And some examples you can see right now with our friends in Malaga. We went for a trip, we did some lifestyle session, it was super cool. All right, guys, this brings us to the end. And to recap, one of the ways to be a successful stock photographer is to save your time, to organize neatly your processing and editing and uploading process, collaborating with your friends, exploring new areas, and not checking your sales every hour. And this will guarantee your success, and you will earn way more than we did. Because if we knew all that I'm sharing with you right now, when we started, we would not be talking about 100,000 or 150,000. We would be talking about way more. But I'm sharing this with you, and I hope you liked it, you like this content, and please don't forget to subscribe, to leave thumbs up. Also, comment in the comments below if I missed something out, if there are some things you have to remember about stock photography. This is Jack Sputnik from Jackson Photography, and I see you guys in the next episode.